most 100 populated cities in the United States, there's a path between every one of them. You can go, what's the shortest distance between them? Okay. And that's just something we'll never know. Okay. Now, whenever I teach this, I always get the following thing. Don't worry, I use an apple. They can do it. Don't worry, you know, Steve Jobs is on it. They can do it, you know, no problem, okay? Which brings to a correct answer. I mean, namely, what happens if I have a computer that's faster than this computer? Okay? Let's say it's 10,000 times faster, okay? Which computers over 100 years or whatever, they go 10,000 times faster. So let's say I can do this 10,000 times faster. Okay? Computers that go 10,000 times faster, they only need 2.9 times 10 to the 137 centuries.
If you use, let's say, the supercomputers at the beginning.
I'll be right there. I'll be right there. Okay, so computers go 10,000 times faster, so you've gone down from 10 to the 142 centuries down to 137 centuries. You're not doing much better. Okay? Now, question. What happens if you have a supercomputer? Like nowadays, all the IBM, the computers are all dual processors. What does that mean? It has two different processors. And Macs, I'm sure, have better. Whatever, with all the Mac computers there, I defer to you 100%. But let's say you had a computer with 10,000 processors. How does that help? Okay? Same thing. 10 to the 137 centuries. You're not doing much better. Okay, now, there's a fancy thing called quantum computers, which don't exist yet, but, hold on, very important. I wrote a book on quantum computers, so I'm trying to sell it. Okay, quantum computers, out of this book, will change your life. Quantum computers are computers that do, that take the weird things of quantum mechanics, and one of the strange things about quantum mechanics is you can be in more than one place at one time, and you can do all types of weird things. So maybe if I had a quantum computer doing this traveling salesman column, maybe I can do it a little bit better. And the answer is, if we ever built a quantum computer, it would, but it'll only take 10 to the 71 centuries. Not doing much better. Okay? So these problems are, it's not going to be fixed. You're not going to get a real solution to this problem anytime soon. Okay? And there are really limitations to man's ability to know things, people's ability to know things. Okay. There is one other thing. What about finding a better algorithm? Okay? So, this is a stupid thing to do, to go through all possibilities. Maybe there's a better algorithm. Okay? Fine. I agree. There's been a search for an improved algorithm for almost 50 years to no avail. No one's been able to find a better algorithm. They're going through all possibilities. Now, you can fix it a little bit, but to get an answer for all possible graphs like that, there's no better algorithm. No, I didn't say it doesn't exist. Okay? It probably does not exist. Most people think it doesn't exist, and you really have to go through all possibilities, but that doesn't mean it doesn't exist, just it means it doesn't. Okay. But no one proved it yet. This is a strange thing. So we don't have a better algorithm, but we can't prove that none doesn't exist yet. Okay? And proving this is called solving the P is equal to NP problem. And so one of these problems. And it's one of the seven millennium problems, the seven problems in math that were taken in 2000. And if you solve any of them, you get $1 million. Okay, so if you find a better algorithm, or if you prove that no better algorithm exists, you get $1 million. And I just want to say, one of these seven problems has been solved already.
Yeah.
Okay, and so the rush is on. Okay, because the other six. So if you're going to do it this weekend. Send me an email, and I'll bring it in. So this is just one thing. The hard computer problems. There are many computer problems that, and by the way, I just mentioned one problem, but there is obviously a lot. There are many computer problems that are easy to state. I can tell a six-year-old about the traveling salesman problem. Not only a singer, but a six-year-old kind of solves it for small problems very easily. Show up all over, but nevertheless, for any non-trivial inputs, in other words, for anything large, like 100 or 50, they will be essentially unsolvable. And you won't be able to solve. Okay? Okay, let's talk about physics. Okay, since the time of Newton, so we think of the universe as like a flawless functioning large clock. We have gears and things are turning, and we have Newton's given us these laws of how things work, etc., etc. We envision gears and springs that interact perfectly and with total predictability. In other words, if we sat down and we had took all the physics course, we'd be able to figure out anything perfectly and get all the information. Okay, and here's a quote from Laplace, who kind of said that, but he said it in French, and I don't know French, so we don't have to read it. But, so that's fine. Okay, in the 1960s, this guy, Edward Lorenz, he was a mathematician and a meteorologist. And so he was studying different weather patterns and how things were interacting and stuff like that. And he had a bunch of equations, not these equations, but I couldn't find the equations in the version. There were five or six nice equations where he was putting it. Now, the equations depend on each other, so there's a type of feedback, because there's feedback in weather. You know, if it gets colder, then this is going to happen, which is going to get this, which is going to get that, which is going to make it colder, and things like that. So these are the equations you have. And they have feedback, and they're not, you know, linear equations, because the weather is not linear. Okay. Now, this is the 1960s, so he plugs these equations into a computer, and he watches the weather patterns form. And one day, he sees a very interesting weather pattern, and he likes it. And he, you know, there's no fancy graphics, they're all computers and with numbers, and the numbers pop out. Okay, the next day he wants to see that same weather pattern again. So he plugs it into the computer. But rather than plugging 0.506127, he just plugs in 0.506, which is very close. In fact, it's 1,000th away from what it was. And he wants to see the same weather pattern, okay, that he saw before. Surprisingly, the weather pattern that came out was totally different from the one he was aiming. Okay, even though he had put in all the numbers very close, but it was totally different. Lorenz realized that for these simple equations, the way the different parts interact with each other, and the way outcomes of some of the equations become inputs to other equations, cause major changes in weather patterns depending on starting positions. So if you what happened was, he started with something very close to what he was aiming at, but it was a little bit different. And what happened after a little while of doing these, you know, weather formations, it turned out totally, totally different. Okay, and he was shocked. So he wrote a paper about it. And the paper was called Predictability. It was in some journal. Predictability. Does the flap of a butterfly's wing in Brazil set off a tornado in Texas? It's one of the great titles of old papers. You always have that good title. Okay, and the idea is as follows. Okay, there's a map. I love PowerPoint. Okay, here's a butterfly, and there's a tornado. Okay, the idea is as follows. Namely, with small, minute changes over here, you can make major things over here. Now, don't think for a second that, you know, butterflies cause tornadoes. If you do, there are a lot of people are going to go to Brazil and kill out all the butterflies. No, it's not. In fact, if anything, you know, there might be a tornado forming here because a butterfly flipped its wings and he pushed it away. So that's also a possibility. But the idea is as follows, is things are beyond predictability because little changes can cause major changes. That's the whole thing of this chaos theory. Little changes can cause major changes. And what we get out of this is called in popular culture the butterfly effect, and it gives us bad movies. With apologies to anybody who has a crush on acting, for sure. Sorry. But the technical term is as follows. Extremely sensitive dependence on initial conditions. In other words, what happens in the beginning, initial conditions of how you start off your equations, that's going to make major changes. So very sensitive, a little bit of a change, 1,000th of a difference, you can get a whole totally different. Okay, now what does that say about our ability to predict the future? Okay. I'm sorry, what it said over there was Laplace's dream was over. Laplace was the thing I skipped in the beginning, but what we're trying to say is as follows. In chaos theory, what it says is there are many simple systems that are easy to describe, totally deterministic. You write out equations that tell you exactly what's going to happen perfectly. okay? And yet there's no way that we'll be able to predict their actions for any reasonable amount of time. You can predict a little bit because the little changes didn't cause the major changes yet. So I can tell you probably with 90% accuracy whether, or with 80% accuracy, whether it's going to rain tomorrow. But for 2 days, I really can't. And you can look at all the newspapers, I'm really not. And for 3 days, probably not. And for 4 days, it'll more often than not be wrong. Okay? And that's all because predictability, and not only the weather, but in many other systems where this chaos theory is, it's not predictable. There's no way to predict. Okay, let's talk a little bit about relativity theory. Okay, so that was something. So, first thing about relativity theory, or special relativity, is built on two axioms. Okay? One is the speed of light is not instant. Now, that's a strange thing to realize. You can turn on the light, and the room lights up. So that's a very interesting thing. But it's not instant. It's not instantaneous. It takes time. And that's something that took people a long time to see. But it's based on this beautiful experiment that was done in the 1630s that it's worthy of seeing. So it was done in 1670, Okay, so it's a cute little experiment. You have the Earth going around the Sun. Everything's not drawn to size, okay? And you have Jupiter, and Jupiter has a moon called Io. Now you have to realize 1676 is not far after Galileo when they just discovered telescopes. Okay, so they were just telescopes. Now, this guy, Romer, was standing on Earth over here, and he's looking at Io going around Jupiter. It's going around and around, and he assumes that it's going around at a set pace. Okay? And he watches. Now, Io is a little moon that he can see with his telescope, and then it goes behind Jupiter, and he can't see it anymore. It's eclipsed by Jupiter, and then it comes out. And then it goes around, and it comes out. And it goes around, and it comes out. Okay? Now, Romer is measuring the time distance, the time it takes for the moon to go around. He's measuring it over here, and he's measuring it. It's a typical academic. He's taking his time. He's doing it in the spring, and he's doing it in the fall. And then he measures it over here, too. Okay? And he sees that the time Io goes to go around Jupiter takes longer when he's over here than when he's over here. And he's an astronomer. He knows when he's over here, and he knows when he's over there. Now, he wonders why. Okay. Why should it be that Io takes longer when he's here than when he's there? Okay. Now, the answer is as follows. What he postulated was that it takes longer for the time for the light of Io to come all the way here as opposed to come all the way there. Now, he does some calculations. He knows how far Jupiter is from Earth over here. He knows how far Jupiter is from Earth over there. And he does some nice calculations. And he comes to that it must be that the speed of light is constant. It takes time to travel. And he gives you an approximation to how fast the speed of light goes.
How much did he get for the speed of light at the time?
I don't remember exactly, but he's not far off. Mm-hmm. Maybe like halfway off Earth. It wasn't like 10 times more. Mm-hmm. Okay? And over the centuries, they improved the ability to go. Okay, so he gets this. Okay. Next, that's more intuitive. That, you know, everything else takes time in this world. The speed of light should also take time. Okay? It's not intuitive because we don't see it. By us, it looks instant. In fact, we measure sound by the speed of light as if it's instant, right? So you hear you see the lightning, you hear the thunder, and you count how different. But you assume that the lightning hits you immediately. Well, at 186,000 miles per second, it's almost immediate. Okay, the next thing is not very intuitive, and it goes as follows. The speed of light is always perceived as constant. Now, that's a strange thing. Let me just say, if a car is coming this way and I'm going this way, I'm gonna perceive the car as moving faster. If I'm going this way and the car is going this way, I'm gonna perceive the car as going slow. Okay? So usually, the way you view something, that's the way you're going to perceive it, okay? Either faster or slower. Okay. But it's not true with light. Light is always perceived as going constant, at a constant speed. Okay. Now, here's a cute little experiment that shows this. This is from 1913, after Einstein, but it was a nice experiment, anyways. And it goes as follows. this guy, William DeSitter, he had looked at